Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Want to welcome you to this, our second week of Counseling the Culturally Different. Of course, this is the fourth hour. The third session. We're covering two sessions a night and hour and a half each session. That's a total of 3 hours per setting. That's a long time per setting, but this is a two-hour course. This is a two-college credit course. Last week, we looked at the politics of counseling and psychotherapy, and the second session, the socio-political considerations of trust and mistrust in multicultural counseling and therapy. As I recall, we did not complete the chapter. I'll go back and pick up on what I think would be the important principles that we missed, and then we'll take a look at our topics for tonight. Let me say once again that we're going to be studying this course from a Christian perspective. The author of the book, the authors are secular counselors. We do have a unique situation in Christian counseling that is distinct from secular counseling, and maybe some of these considerations will not be as important in a Christian setting. For example, you're not going to have anybody that's going to be coming to you in a forced situation. They're not going to be coming for involuntary counseling. Of course, that's going to be the situation in any field, that you're going to have a totally different response if a person comes voluntarily than if they come involuntarily. So many of the situations where we're talking about trust and mistrust may not be as much of an issue in a Christian setting, because you're assuming that a person is going to be coming to you maybe with a high level of trust. However, a person could come to a Christian counselor in a church setting and not know very much about that counselor. They may just simply be coming on the recommendation of someone else, or they may call the church office and the church office recommends that you give Dr. Metters a call. And when you get into the counseling situation, you may come to the conclusion that Dr. Metters is not the person you thought he was. And you may not feel that he's a person that you would want to divulge any personal information to. But that's always going to be the case. And of course, any time that you're involved in a directive style of counseling, especially when you get down to confrontation, or even if you get down to advice giving, a person may decide that your advice is not what they were looking for. I have primarily been, I guess, pretty much of a non-directive counselor. That would probably be my theoretical, background early on. I would probably characterize myself more as a cognitive behavioral counselor. And for those of you who have not taken previous courses in counseling, that may be a little bit foreign to you. In fact, tonight I think I'm going to take a little bit of time to maybe go back and review some of these theoretical points of view so that it'll make a little bit more sense. But you have to understand that you're going to have a different situation oftentimes in a Christian setting than you would in a non-Christian setting. You're going to have a different situation where you have voluntary counseling and involuntary counseling. Hopefully, for those of you who are in the counseling program for the entire program, that you're going to have a pretty solid background, that hopefully some of you may end up with a secular job. That'd be great. But let's complete some of our considerations from last week. I think the last thing that we were talking about was ethnocentric monoculturalism. What do we mean by ethnocentric monoculturalism? Ethnocentric, okay, monoculturalism would refer to one culture, and that one culture would be centered around race or ethnicity. Ethnocentric monoculturalism. And of course, this nation is becoming much more multicultural, but it has been very predominantly what culture?
White.
Middle class, white, Euro American, Eurocentric. You have had traditionally in this country two major focal or ethnic groups that would be the center of attention, and that would be your Eurocentric and your Afrocentric. Now, of course, we have other minority groups in this country, and the major minority groups in this country would be what?
Hispanic.
Other than blacks, would be?
Hispanic.
Hispanic?
Asian.
Asian Americans. And there's one more that we consider to be a major culture. Native Americans. Okay, so basically we have the white culture, we have black culture, Asian culture, Hispanic, and American Indian. That certainly is not all inclusive, but those would represent the major ethnic groups in this country, and those will be the ones that we'll be considering. In fact, those will be the ones that we'll go in more detail at the end of the class, at the end of the course, when we look at counseling and therapy with specific populations. Okay. Some of the components, this I think is a review. We talked about this last week. Some of the components, the five major components of ethnocentric monoculturalism is, number one, a belief in superiority. The belief in the superiority of one culture over another culture. And corresponding to that would be the belief in the inferiority of all others.
Would you repeat that?
Well, one would be the superiority of the dominant culture, and then the second would be the corresponding belief in the inferiority of all others. One would be the superiority of the white culture, the belief in the superiority of the white culture, and the belief in the inferiority of all others. Of course, going all the way back to our first session, we talked about being deprived heritage-wise. What we're talking about being deficient as far as what you inherit, your traits, your traits of intelligence. So what's the terminology that I'm looking for? We're talking about, okay, genetics. That's the term I'm trying to, that's what I'm looking for, genetics. We looked at the genetically deficient model, and then we looked at the culturally deficient model, and we basically said that both of those were insufficient to describe accurately the situation, and more accurately we should consider what? Instead of saying that a person is genetically deficient, or even that they're culturally deficient, what would be the more appropriate way to address? Culturally different, just to simply acknowledge that people are different. In other words, we don't necessarily have to acknowledge the fact that a person is deficient either genetically or environmentally. Now again, to assume that a person is deficient either genetically or environmentally would be to say that this person comes up short of some particular standard, and that standard, of course, being what? I know y'all so involved in writing your notes there, it's hard for you to write notes and think at the same time. But think about it, it's not real complicated. It's another question I asked, is not real complicated. To say that a person is deficient would be based on comparing that person with a set standard. And that standard being what? Okay, that standard being the monocultural, the ethnocentric monocultural white standard. Okay, but the multicultural approach is to simply acknowledge that a person is different. To say that a person is genetically deficient, and again, let's make this crystal clear that we say that all men are created equal. No, not all people are created equal. It depends on what you mean by being equal. There are some people born with a gold spoon in their mouth, some born with a silver spoon in their mouth, and some born with no spoon in their mouth, right? There are some people who are born with no physical disabilities, and some are born without arms and legs. There are some people who basically have brain damage from birth. A person may be born blind, or they may be born with some other physical defect. Now, the point is that there may be something missing there. A person may be, quote, deprived. A person may not have everything physically and materially that someone else has. There are some people who have high IQs because of what they inherit genetically. There are some people who inherit a low IQ. But what we have to guard against is to make a blanket statement that one race is more intelligent than another race, or that one race is superior in any aspect from another. But again, using the example of an athlete, if you're going to measure the ability of an athlete by whether they're able to play in the NBA, the NFL, or Major League Baseball, maybe not so much in Major League Baseball. There's probably a higher percentage of whites in Major League Baseball, but it's pretty obvious that blacks are the better athletes in football and basketball, especially basketball. Now, when we say that it would be racist for us to attribute superiority across the board according to race, then what's the other explanation? What would be another explanation as to why that blacks are higher achievers on the basketball court? What's that?
They inherited
their physical makeup.
Yeah. Well, wait, now y'all missing the whole point here. Now, let's back up a little bit here. What you're saying is, what you are basically saying is, you're making the same statement that Jack Nicklaus made when he said that blacks don't have the physical makeup to play golf, and what others have said that, blacks have genetically been endowed with certain muscles. I've even heard people make statements that blacks had extra muscles that whites didn't have. There's no scientific proof to that. Now, you may have more developed muscles because you use them more. Okay, let's think about it. You know, if you're going to say across the board that all blacks are lean and muscular, that's not true.
That's not true?
Yeah. You know, you have all shapes, sizes. You have people of varying abilities across the whole spectrum. But one of the explanations is that blacks are better basketball players because, you know, if you grew up in the ghetto, sometimes that's the only form of entertainment that you have. That may be the only form of socialization. That may be what you're doing all day long. You're playing on the playground. The whites in the middle class or upper class white neighborhoods may be out in their speedboat, or they may be out on their four-wheeler or their motorcycle or their Jaguar, you know. And so the whole point is that, you know, even anybody, not necessarily black, but anybody of a lower economic social status may find sports to be something to occupy themselves, or they may see it as a ticket out of the ghetto. Now, what happens racially when you make statements like that you attribute blacks, when you confess that blacks are superior physically, that opens the door for you to say, okay, we concede that blacks are superior physically, but then what would they counteract? What would whites counteract with? What would they counteract with?
They'd counteract with their intelligence.
Exactly. That's exactly right. So one is just as racial as the other. For you to say that whites are more intelligent than blacks across the board would be racist. By the same token, for you to attribute any attribute to a group of people based on their race would also be racist.
That's right.
Now, again, you may give black kids an IQ test and give white kids an IQ test, and as a whole, white kids might score higher on the IQ test. But still, what would be a problem there, or what would be a potential problem?
Part of it would be what they've been exposed to.
Okay, and of course that would be assuming environmental deficiency. But what else could it imply?
Culture.
Okay, culture. But there's something else. No, y'all thinking too deep here.
The parental upbringing?
No. Okay. And all of those are true. And when you say parental upbringing, and for you just to say that blacks are deficient because of parental upbringing would be an indictment against the parents, wouldn't it?
Right.
Okay, so the point I'm getting at here is that if you are basing achievement, or if you're basing accomplishments on a test score, what is the problem?
It's not
what fair. Is what? What's that?
It's not a fair measurement of what's.
What are some of the criticisms of tests?
Some are good test takers and some aren't. Some freeze up. Some have brain block. Mental blocks.
Fear. Fear. Anxiety.
So does that weigh in favor one race over another race? I mean,
no.
No. I mean, okay. What is one of the criticisms against using test as a measurement to classify or to place?
Culturally. It's culturally biased.
Okay. All right. Again.
Geared toward the white.
Okay. Again, standardized test, the content of standardized test have traditionally been considered to be reflective or representative of white culture. Okay? A second consideration is that when you have standardized tests, how standardized tests work is that, and the reason why they call it a standardized test is because that you have come up with norms, you have come up with standards that are based on a group of people who have taken that test, and you compare a person's performance on the test against that standard or against that norm. And that's the reason why you call them standardized. Okay? And one of the criticisms has been that the norm group, the reference group that these standards have been based on, have not been representative of all of the different cultures. Okay? So you may be comparing a minority with a standard of the dominant culture, which has been basically the middle class white culture. Okay, so a lot of this is review. It's a kind of an overview, but to put everything in the proper context, put everything in focus so that we can get a grip on what we're dealing with here. And, you know, the truth is that according to the standards of educational systems, according to standardized tests, that there have been indications that blacks have scored lower. If you to make a statement to say that that's an indication that the black race is inferior would be a false statement. And again, we have to consider that you have people along the whole spectrum from low to high in all races. So this is something that we want to consider as we continue to move along in our textbook. So remember this. I promise you this will come up as a test question.
Do you have the textbooks here?
Yeah.
How much are they?
You've already paid for yours, haven't you?
No, sir.
You haven't?
No, sir.
Okay, just see me after class. I thought you had. Okay, but go ahead.
Thank you.
Yeah, we'll talk about that during break.
So what was that test question?
I got your attention, didn't I?
Yes.
I will promise you. Now, Lord, help me to remember this and help me to keep a promise. I don't want to make a promise I can't keep.
That's right.
You know, if you promise your kids a spanking, you've got to follow through with it. So if I promise you to be responsible, I've got to stick with it. I'm very sure that you will probably be asked to state the three basic models which explain differences in performance. And one is the genetically deficient.
Why did you learn something?
Well, you've already written this down three times.
Well, I got to have this test question.
Okay. I mean, I gave this to you a while ago. Just go back and put a star beside it. All right, number one is the genetically deficient model. Go back and see if you haven't already written that down.
How would you phrase it?
How would you phrase that?
Basic
it would be what are the three models that would explain differences of performance? That would be one way. One would be the genetically deficient model. And that basically is the belief that people are born different, or they inherit certain genetic characteristics that are either superior or inferior. The second model is a culturally deficient model, and that is assuming that a person is deficient. To say that a person is culturally deficient would insinuate that they are culturally deprived. But the truth is that everybody has a culture that they come from. You know, the slaves that came from Africa came from a culture. The white slave masters would not have considered that to have been a culture. They would not have acknowledged their culture as being a legitimate culture. And here's another, I think this is another great wrong that has been perpetrated by the church. And that is I think there's almost been a concept in missionary programs that it's necessary for us to go into a foreign country and to, quote, civilize people or to westernize people. I'm a firm believer, even in missionary endeavors, that the job of a missionary ought to be to raise up native leaders, to raise up ministers and churches that are led by the dominant culture. It's not our job to go and to try to change people's customs. Of course, when we seek to Christianize people, the nations of the earth, we do consider certain things as being civilized, such as putting clothes on. You know, well, we probably believe as Christians that if you get saved, you ought to put some clothes on. All right, the third model is just simply to recognize that people are just simply different, culturally diverse. So you have genetically deficient, and culturally diverse.
That's 18, 20, 21.
Okay. What do we mean by the invisible veil? When you're talking about one of the components of ethnocentric monoculturalism, what do we mean by the invisible veil? Y'all probably don't remember that unless you go back and read your notes. Okay.
The values that blind us from the reality.
Is that what you have in your notes? Or are you just making that up?
No, that's what I thought. Values represent an invisible veil that blinds us to the reality of truth.
Okay, and basically when you talk about the invisible veil, that is the values and beliefs that operate outside of our level of conscious awareness. Well, there's a veil that blinds us that we're not even aware of. And one of the things that we're referring to, of course, is racial prejudice. Oftentimes, we may not be aware that we're prejudiced, and that represents an invisible veil.
That makes us operate outside of what?
Of the level of conscious awareness. We operate oftentimes as a result of this invisible veil. We operate outside of the bond, outside the bounds of conscious awareness. So, when you, for example, one of the objectives I would think of this course would be to raise our awareness, to raise our level of awareness
of other cultures.
Of other cultures, and at the same time that brings to light possible things that are out of our awareness that may represent prejudices. Okay? And when you become aware of other people's values and other people's beliefs, other people's customs, and other cultures, then that gives us the means by which that we can judge our own hearts. And I think the work of the Holy Spirit is to bring to our awareness, to bring to the surface. You know, sometimes things cannot be dealt with until they're brought to the surface. When we're put under pressure, the pressure will bring to surface certain preconceived notions. When you have more understanding, when you have more knowledge, that enables you to deal with stereotypes. You know, stereotypically, we associate certain characteristics, certain attributes to people just because they belong to a certain group. You may draw conclusions just based on the fact that somebody's black or because somebody is Asian American. I think of one of the examples given in one of the chapters we're going to be looking at tonight, and again, y'all remind me if there's a difference in the textbooks. As I told you last week, that I am using a little bit newer edition. You have a little older edition because it was cheaper. That book was about less than half. I think I said this book was $75. I believe that if you go online, the book is about $75. I only paid $50 for mine, so I gave you a misrepresentation, but you got your book for $20. So,
That's the newer edition?
Yeah, a little bit. It's a little bit more updated, and sometimes, as you discovered last week, that one of the case studies was just a little bit different. So your main concepts, your main principles are going to be the same, so don't get stuck on that. Okay, let's look at some of the therapeutic impact, therapeutic impact of ethnocentric monoculturalism. From the analysis of African American history, what is defined as the dissociative process. Now let me encourage everybody. I don't know how much reading. I see that Seal has some highlights there, and then of course some of your books look real clean. And
I wasn't here last week.
Oh, that's right. That's the reason your book looks clean. And okay, and so that means you're going to have a lot of catching up to do to read up on your material. And let me just let me verify what somebody's already stated here tonight, and I think that Seal made the statement that this is not a real easy textbook. And when you say it's not a real easy textbook, it's my job to try to break it down, try to make sense out of it, and to try to help you to decipher the main concepts and principles, okay? Let me encourage you to read the material before you come to class, because what you're doing right now is you're scanning through the book. You're trying so desperately to find what I'm talking about here, and you're not listening to me, okay? You need to concentrate on listening to me. That's where your main focus needs to be. You need to take notes, and I'll try to break it down so that you can take some simple notes, as simple as possible. Everybody understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Don't lose focus by trying to, you know, look and dig it out. Read the material before you come to class, and that'll at least give you a familiarity. And I'll promise you that, you know, reading through something one time, especially for some of you who may not have a real solid background in counseling, as I explained to you last week, it would have been better had you had the introduction courses to counseling. And when I think it's necessary, I'll try to explain some of the counseling theories as we go along. But try to focus as much as you can on the discussion. One of the things I would like to do that can only be done if you read the material is that I realize that 3 hours is a long time at one setting, and the more we can get involved in some discussion or to get you involved, I think it will be a whole lot better, make it to be more interesting. But you know, again, if you don't read the material, you're going to be just sitting there looking like a calf looking at a new gate, right? You're just going to wonder, what in the world is, what's this all about?
If we change chapters, like we started out at finishing up on chapter, was it one?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so when we get ready to go into chapter two, will you let us know when we're going into chapter two? So I'm just
yeah, okay. Absolutely. In fact, right now, we're talking about, we're still in what is your chapter 4, isn't it? Okay, your chapter 4 is socio-political considerations of trust and mistrust, right? Is that your chapter 4? Okay. Socio-political considerations of trust and mistrust in multicultural counseling. That's chapter 4, right?
Is that what we're in right now?
Yeah.
Because we discussed this last week.
Yeah, and what I'm trying to do really is to draw a conclusion. I'm trying to leave you with the concluding thoughts of ethnocentric monoculturalism.
So we're on chapter 4.
And that should be chapter 4. But again, concentrate on what I'm trying to give you, not try to look it up in the book, okay? What I have on the board here is what is called the dissociative process. Dissociative personality disorders is a category in counseling and psychology, clinical psychology. What we mean by dissociative is like a separation of the parts of a person. The ideal is that all parts of your personality, all parts of your being be integrated, right? That there be an association, right? So dissociative refers to like a separation. Everybody follow me?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. For example, a schizophrenic would be a type. Schizophrenia is a separate category, but in a sense, that's like a denial of a certain part of you. There's like a one part of you that is totally separated. There's a public image that's separated from your personal image. And so a lot of things, and the whole point here in multicultural studies is to point out that what may be interpreted traditionally as being a psychological disorder might be explained by a person's cultural background. And that's the whole purpose of our studying this class, is that if you can understand why a person behaves the way they do, their behavior may be more reflective of their culture than it would be of some abnormality. And again, isn't that what we're talking about, is what we call deviation from the norm as being abnormal? Deviation from the norm would be considered to be abnormal. Now, there are a lot of people that are abnormal. That doesn't necessarily mean they're bad. If you have 140 IQ, you're not really normal. That doesn't mean that you're crazy. That does not mean that you're strange. Now, some people are. But just because you have 140 IQ does not necessarily make you some deviant. Now, you do deviate from the norm. If you have 140 IQ, it's going to probably put you in about the top 0.5% of the population. In fact, 130 IQ puts you in about the top 1 or 2%, you know, nationwide. So the whole point here is that if you're measuring somebody's behavior as how far they deviate from the norm, remember, how do you come up with the norms? What are the norms? What reflects the norms, okay? So what may be, according to certain standards, would be, quote, abnormal, that in the counseling field or in the field of psychology, that you would say this person is psychologically imbalanced, or they have some kind of psychological disorder, or it may be a diagnosis that says this person needs to be institutionalized. You remember what I said last week about if we're not careful, that we could view a person that has a different point of view from ourselves as being abnormal, and this is a way that people have dealt with their political enemies. I mean, there have been people who have actually been institutionalized because they had a different political point of view.
That's terrible.
You know. All right, so disassociation or dissociative personality would be a type of denial of an aspect of a person. Let me give you another example of dissociation. Separating your true self from the role that you play. In other words, there's some people who play out a role that is different than their true self. This would be what we may refer to as the true self versus the social self.
Kind of like a Sybil.
Kind of like?
A Sybil, you know, like Sybil. The multi-personality.
Oh, okay. Well, that would be, yeah, that would be actually... Yeah, Sybil represented multiple personalities. She had 16 different personalities. And that would be a dissociative type personality. But there, you know, everybody's not that extreme.
Right.
I mean, for you to put on a mask, and we wear a mask all the time. Because we want to portray to others oftentimes what we think is the most socially acceptable presentation, right?
So is that an example of this then?
Well, it could be that when you portray something socially that's different than your true self or your true feelings or your true intent, right? So, you know, When you bring your true self in alignment with your public self, your inner self with your public self. Everybody understand what I'm speaking about?
Mm-hmm.
When those come more in agreement, then when you think that would probably be more reflective of a healthy personality or a health, it would be healthier mentally, wouldn't it? You'd be considered more mentally healthy if there is more of an agreement with your true self and what you portray.
We headed towards genuineness.
Okay, genuineness.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and yeah, and you know, there's so many ways that we can integrate mm-hmm. what is inner with what is outer. Another would be the agreement of verbal and nonverbal. That's what we call congruence, being congruent. Congruence, well, actually what we're talking about right now is a type of congruence. That when your personal self or your inner self is more in agreement with your public self, that would be congruence. The two are congruent. And that would probably be more reflective of what we would call a, quote, whole personality or a healthy personality, okay? Now, the truth is that people are not always, they're not accurate in their portrayal, in their expression of feelings or their thoughts or even in what other people interpret them as being or where they're coming from. And let me just bring to your attention some ways that the dissociative process has been manifested in African Americans. From the analysis of African American history, the dissociative process may be manifested in two major ways. The dissociative process may be manifested in two major ways. Number one is what is called playing it cool. Playing it cool may mean that what you're portraying may not be a reflection of your true self, right? Mm-hmm. And the second is the Uncle Tom syndrome. And the truth is that both of these have been ways, or these have been means by which that blacks have been able to conceal their true feelings. It has actually been a means of survival. It has been an adaptive process. And let me give you a little bit further explanation here. The purpose of playing it cool, what has been called playing it cool, has been a means by which that blacks historically have sought to prevent whites from knowing what he or she is thinking or feeling, or to present themselves in such a way that it would be perceived as being less offensive or threatening. In other words, blacks have learned historically how to present themselves in a way that allowed them to be more adaptive, and one way has been to hide their true feelings. Because if they express their true feelings, they would have alienated. You know, one of the things that I have learned in studying this class, let me say this up front. I'm probably going to learn as much from this class as you are. And I don't present myself as an expert in multicultural studies. This is something that I have become interested in the last couple of years. I think it's very needed, very necessary. I think it's needed very much in the church world. There needs to be a greater appreciation of other people, of other cultures. But keep this in mind, that even though that we do have people from different cultures that come together in the body of Christ, that theoretically, technically, in the body of Christ ought to be one culture. That's a heavenly culture. That's the Christ culture. That's the kingdom of God culture. Amen. But you still don't deny your background. You don't deny where you're coming from. You don't deny your experiences. You don't deny your upbringing. Because the truth is that even now, we can come together as one people, one mind, one spirit, one body, and still can come from totally different walks of life.
Yes.
We still have our peculiar likes and dislikes, right? And you can't judge another person and say that what they believe is necessarily inferior. Now, see, what you believe scripturally, what you believe spiritually, shouldn't necessarily be open for interpretation. I'm assuming that we all come together under one umbrella, and that one umbrella is the Bible. That one umbrella is the cross of Christ, is the blood of Jesus. That one umbrella is the church that we identify with. It's our spiritual leader, right? You know, so all of those things bring us into a commonality. But there's no reason why that we would have to lose our distinctiveness, or to lose our personality, or to lose our cultural heritage. You know, this may be just kind of a minor thing to some people. Oh my Lord, we're not getting anywhere near to covering all of our material, but you know, hey, let's just move the way we're going. I think it's fine. One of the things that I think that happens when different cultures come together, and in this church, The two major cultures are black culture and white culture. And I think that as we grow together, as we blend together as a body of Christ, there's less attention being drawn to the differences between black and white. Again, there ought to be one culture, and that's a heavenly culture. But we talked about this last week. God is not necessarily colorblind. God knows what color you are.
Sure.
Who's that? Somebody was, that was a speaker Sunday morning. You remember Senator Kratz that was here? And his wife said that they were somewhere, and this little black kid said, "That's the whitest man they ever saw." And so God's not colorblind. You know, God knows what color your hair is. He knows what color your eyes are. He knows what color your skin is. You don't deny that. But there is less and less distinction that is made in the body of Christ. Now, getting back to the one of the things that I'm coming to understand is that acknowledging our limitations, acknowledging our weaknesses, being able to bring to the surface things that we're not even aware of, I think is healthy. Because if it's the wrong way to think, if it's the wrong way to deal with situation, we need to allow the Holy Spirit to change us. Now, one of the things that I am very quick to admit, and I got to think about this, and I'm thinking, well, you know, I shouldn't have to keep justifying my position, and I shouldn't have to continue to be defensive. And sure enough, what I read here backed up what I was thinking, and that is that if you say that you've always been accepting, you've always been understanding, is probably not a truth. Because we're all products of our upbringing. You know, the truth is, I was brought up in the South. I was brought up in the prejudiced South. You've got to understand, you know, people of my age were brought up. Now, see, y'all jumped to conclusions. Y'all was there, Well, it's no great secret. I mean, all you had to do is look at my wife and know that I wasn't born yesterday.
It's terrible.
You know, and it's what I tell people, I say, look, if you've got 40-year-old kids, you can't hide your age, right? I have a daughter who's going to be 40 next week. You know,
so. She looks
22. Huh?
She looks 22.
That's right.
Are you the one who told her that?
She does.
She told me that someone told her that. I said, that person must be blind.
She does.
She agreed with me. She looks
maybe 32. Yeah, she maybe 32.
I looked at her. I knew she was your daughter because she looked like an engineer, computer analysis.
That's what she is.
Huh? Nancy, that's why I thought she was the baby. Because I thought she was way younger.
I thought she was a
no,
baby.
No, she's going to be 40 next week.
She got it.
She looks
very young.
So my point here is, you know, there are certain things you cannot deny, right?
Right.
Okay. I mean, if you have a 40-year-old daughter, you would assume that you've been married longer than that. We have.
I'm sure she's gonna appreciate that on tape too.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I have a beautiful daughter. I mean, her spirit is just.
Oh, she! I think she's wonderful. Is. I really do.
I knew she was. I looked at this part. Yeah. Nancy.
Yeah, she's very special. Okay, so the point is that if I, a person my age, being born in the generation I was born in and it really wouldn't make any difference whether the North or the South, because I'm going to tell you this, there have certainly been more rights and laws that have been favorable to the blacks in the North for much longer than the South, but there's plenty of prejudice in the North.
There sure is.
In fact, what's that?
And more in the South, against black. When I moved to the South, I was called a Yankee. I would get so mad at what they would call me that.
They call you a Yankee? Well, that wasn't racial. That was...
No, that was to make me mad.
Well, let me ask you a question. Are you a Yankee?
No. Oh. I can't pass the basic things in my life. I got my job.
Okay. Okay, and you know, and I made this statement in this class last week that unfortunately there is as much geographical sectional prejudice as there is almost racial.
There sure is.
In the Deep South, there is still a lot of prejudice toward people from the North.
Yeah, that's what I was just telling you about. Yeah. I mean, they just didn't like me. They said, listen to her, she came from the top.
Look, I went to New Jersey for basic training. I'm coming straight out of Georgia going to New Jersey. I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. So were you discriminated against, or did they have prejudice?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
All right. I ain't that the truth.
Getting back to my point. Is that the important thing is that we, first of all, we recognize our weaknesses. I found myself almost feeling like I had to defend. You know, even the story I told you, I believe, last week about some of the things that we've been through in the past 30 years and some of the things that we were persecuted for, almost felt like I had to tell that to, you know, almost like to prove that, you know, hey, for 30 years now that we've been dealing with these issues. And I'm not even sure that that's important even to talk about. But to recognize that there are attitudes that we've had to deal with, and there are several reasons why that I believe that there's a change of attitude. And there is. There's still prejudices. And where people think they can get away with it, they would probably discriminate. Yeah. But when you're in business and industry, it's more difficult now to discriminate. There was a lot of discrimination in the government, even back in World War II. A lot of discrimination. In fact, there was a lot of discrimination up until the Civil Rights Movement in the 1960s. But I grew up in a time when I didn't have, early on, I did not have a positive opinion of Martin Luther King. I did not have a positive opinion of Muhammad Ali. I did not have a positive opinion of Malcolm X. And as I have come to... As I have grown, and as I was going to say, there are two reasons why that there's a change of attitude. Number one is the work of Jesus, okay?
Yeah.
And I mean that, and the truth is that's the only thing that's really going to bring about a true change. You cannot change a person's heart.
That's right.
Only God can change a person's heart. And the second thing that is very positive is that the younger generation has had more of an opportunity to coexist and to function in integration, in integrated situations. I grew up in a time where there's no such thing as integration. I grew up in a time when blacks and whites had different water fountains.
Oh, my boys were tickled when they came to this church and saw that. He said, "Mom, is it all white?" And I said, "No, good, because I don't want to go to one that's all white."
And you know, and the truth is, I'm becoming so much more aware of this now than I've ever been, that I look on television, I look at these mega churches that have all white faces, and for some reason I have a feeling, first of all, that is not genuinely reflective of the kingdom of God. And I don't believe that God, we do have black churches, we do have white churches, we have Asian churches, we have Korean churches, African churches. But I believe there's really only one church. Nancy's sister and her husband are Mormons. Her sister is 80 years old. Her husband is, our little story here. I think I just admire Olive and Sankey, that's their names, well, that's his nickname. I admire them highly. I think they're wonderful, wonderful people. Their son was a missionary. Are you from Nigeria?
Yes.
The couple that I'm speaking about, their son was a medical missionary to Nigeria for 16 years. And worked, where was he there, Lagos?
No.
No, it wasn't Lagos.
Benin.
It was probably in a smaller area. But anyway, the whole point is they've always been interested in missions. In fact, he just got back from Afghanistan. He just got back from Afghanistan. He went over. What is it? Okay. But the whole point is that they're really totally dedicated Christians who are interested in people. And this is very honorable. And this is no reflection on their part, but I think it's a shame that the Cambodians have a separate church after 20 years. Now, I think that there are times that when you have the language barrier, that is probably necessary for, you know, for a minority group to have their own church service. In other words, if we want to reach the Spanish-speaking community here, it might be the right thing to do to have a Spanish service. I don't think that should be a permanent arrangement. I think that ultimately what needs to happen is that the cultures come together. And again, the main reason that you would have a separate church would be because of the language barrier. But the truth is that I guess maybe the Cambodians want to keep their own customs. They want to keep their own traditions. And that's understandable also. But I'll tell you another reason is because it's easy for a lot of white congregations to be supportive of minorities, ministering to minorities, as long as they're not right in their, they're not integrated. You know, historically in this country, you go back to right after the Revolutionary War, blacks and whites worshiped in the same church.
Yeah.
Back in the late late part of the 18th century, blacks and whites worshiped in the same church. In fact, the precursor to the AME Church, the African Methodist Episcopal Church, was, I think it was Turner. I forgot who the founder of the church was. But he was leading a prayer meeting in this white church in Philadelphia. And he was reminded that he was praying in the white section of the church. The leaders of the church put him out, and that's when he started the AME church. There was, again, there was a time that blacks and whites worshiped in the same church, but the whites had their section and the blacks had their section. And the black section was usually, you know, in the some far-off corner or was in the balcony. You know, I can remember, I didn't go to about two or three movies all my life growing up. You know, that was the worst sin you could commit was going to a theater. But I remember when I was a kid, that blacks were allowed to go to the theater, but they were not allowed to come down on the main floor. So we have come a long way in getting back to, you know, having a deep respect for some of these black leaders. Now, for many years now, I've had a deep respect for Martin Luther King. And I'm gaining a greater respect for Muhammad Ali, even though he's not a Christian, you know. Muhammad Ali has a great deal of respect. But, you know, I was caught up in the thing that he was a draft dodger, you know, that he didn't, And you know, I'm coming to the place now, and it's all because I haven't educated myself. I haven't availed myself to understanding where these people are coming from.
Well, it's like Medgar Evers over in Mississippi. He was killed about 20 years ago, or maybe even longer than that, by a white man, Byron De La Beckwith. They just had his trial about 3 or 4 years ago over there in Jackson. And the man has gotten away with it, and mankind, he got away with it for so many years, and he just knew he was still going to get away with it. And when they put him on trial, he was convicted of killing Medgar Evers in his driveway in front of his two kids.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, if you want to get your blood pressure up, you go back and read some of the things that happened in the South period, and especially in the state of Mississippi. And I'll tell you this, Georgia hasn't been clear. Georgia does not have a clear conscience. I'll promise you that we've had our share of discrimination. But the whole point is that you learn to appreciate these leaders because they were willing to stand up. They were willing to fight for the rights. They were willing to buck the system. They were willing to lay their lives on the line. And these things we're talking about up here were means by which blacks were able to basically to survive. These were survival means.
What is that?
Okay, the Uncle Tom syndrome basically is what is referred to blacks of being coming across as being docile, non-assertive, happy-go-lucky, being subservient to the white man. This would be an Uncle Tom would be one that would more or less that would, you know, that would take his hat off and tip, and you know, and that would acknowledge the white man, and a person that would be cooperative with the whites would be considered by more assertive blacks as being an Uncle Tom.
It used to be the ones that used to, the blacks that would say, if they were talking to a white, would say yes sir or yes ma'am, you know, showing yeah. That tightness from way back.
And one of the things that we're going to be looking at, I was planning on getting into it tonight, but we're going to be looking at different ways that a person expresses themselves. And you know the fact that blacks would look away, that for them to look a white man in the eye would be like a defiance. Mm-hmm. So, you know, like eye contact, the way that they would hold their head down. And like I say, that when in the 1960s, when you had these black leaders who came forward and were willing to stand up and fight for the rights of the blacks, they didn't endure themselves with the white culture very very well at all. But we look back now with respect and we say that had it not been for some of these black leaders, the blacks would not be enjoying even some of the freedoms that they are enjoying today. I was so moved the other day by a television program that was talking about Muhammad Ali. And Muhammad Ali, y'all know who he is, yeah. Cassius Clay. There were some people who would refuse to acknowledge that he was even Muhammad Ali. They would still call him Cassius Clay. But you remember how that he would be so arrogant and would say, "I'm pretty, you know, I'm beautiful." Well, a lot of that was theater. But one of the things that I heard on this television program that made me really appreciate his accomplishments was the fact that blacks for generations had instilled in them that black was ugly. Black was associated with ugliness. And what Cassius Clay was seeking to do, taking it to the extreme, was to instill a value in the blacks that black is not synonymous with ugly. You know, he referred to himself as being pretty. Now, again, a lot of that was theater. But the end result was that he instilled in the blacks a sense of pride.
Yeah.
And he helped to elevate the self-esteem of the blacks. And I appreciate that. And I know that Malcolm X is probably the thing that I recall that, and I'm going to make it a point to study Malcolm X in more in detail. But one of the things that upset everybody about Malcolm X was, besides his being a convert to Islam and the black Muslims, was his advocacy for bloodshed. In other words, he basically said something to the effect that it may end up being racial war. Now, of course, that's a distinction between Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. Martin Luther King was a peaceful man. And so you've had different leaders with different styles.
Now, was Malcolm X here in the United States?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. In fact, he was.
I don't remember ever hearing a whole lot about Malcolm X growing up. Of course, I heard a lot about Martin Luther
King. Well, Malcolm X was assassinated. And again, you know, I don't know near as much about him as I intend to.
Weren't all of them assassinated?
Huh?
Weren't all of them assassinated?
All of them? Who?
Martin Luther King.
Oh, yeah.
And Malcolm yeah. X. And,
Malcolm X.
Medgar Evers was, yeah. There were several activists.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Well, now,
yeah.
Where did Malcolm X fall in? Was he before Martin Luther? Or
no, he was, Malcolm X, was assassinated in the late 60s, 1960s. In fact, Martin Luther King, Robert Kennedy, and Malcolm X were assassinated along about the same time. But Malcolm X was actually, I think that he was disassociated from I don't know, from the Muslims. I don't quote me on that.
What I was told when I knew him and knew of him and his speech and his grievances was Green Day sprayed away from him and Black sprayed away from him because of the main reason that was stated. He wanted blood. And we were going into the flow, into a peaceful flow. It wasn't into a blood. So people sprayed away from him.
Okay.
Because he was out for blood.
And he was more.
He wasn't nonviolent.
Martin Luther King was nonviolent. Malcolm X was violent.
Right.
And he was more appealing to the black militants.
That'd be like the Black Panthers.
Well, the Black Panthers would have been, yeah. Yeah.
Hell's Angels.
Yeah.
Hell's Angels, was that black?
I don't know who they was, but during the time, this was during the same time as you heard of.
Yeah.
When I heard
it
up
and
to me, it was like all mixed in together.
You know, when
well, and again, you know, as Christians, we would certainly have a tendency to embrace a fellow Christian leader than we would, say, a Muslim, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think that the Muslim religion has appealed to the black man because it has given him an alternative to the white man's religion, what he perceived to be the white man's religion. Christianity, to a lot of blacks, has been identified with the white man. And so what the Muslim religion did was more or less to give a lot of blacks an identity with something that they considered to be anti-establishment, or what was the established accepted norm. But what's this guy's name that led the Million Man March back a few years ago? The black man. Oh my goodness.
I know what you're talking about, Ted. It's right on the tip of my tongue.
You know, and again, there, what was disturbing was the fact he's the head of the Islam Nation, the Nation of Islam. Y'all know who I'm talking about.
Farrakhan.
Yeah, Louis Farrakhan. Okay. Farrakhan did not endure himself, of course, in the Christian community. And what really upset even a lot of blacks, a lot of the black Christian leaders, was the fact that Farrakhan had appealed to a lot of the black Christian men of this nation. Now, they were not attracted to him necessarily based on his Islamic beliefs. And I think that that probably a lot of these men were reached under the auspices or under the umbrella that, you know, this is for the good of the black man. That was what was appealing. But it was a very subtle way, I believe, to bring the message of Islam to the black constituency of this country. You know, this is something else. We haven't even started on our lesson tonight. Oh my goodness. This is something else that I've become aware of in our study of black history over in the academy, is that you have to understand that the black man, when I say black man, I'm speaking about the black race, you're talking about male, female, has probably migrated toward anything that would help to relieve the oppression. Anybody that would offer hope had a chance of pulling the black man in, even the Communist Party. You go all the way back to the 1930s, and we studied about the Scottsboro Boys. Anybody ever heard that story about the Scottsboro Boys? The guys that were hoboing on the train between Chattanooga and Memphis. There were 9 young black males that were accused of raping 2 white girls.
Yeah.
And they were all sentenced to death. It went to trial 3 or 4 times, eventually ended up in the Supreme Court, and probably has become one of the most significant legal cases in this country. You know who defended those 9 black men, those young black men? The Communist Party.
Don't you say
that? The Communist Party. And then eventually the NAACP came in, and they had several organizations that eventually came to their defense. The last of these, all 9 of these guys were eventually set free. They were sentenced to death. They came back to retrial. They were again sentenced to death. The Supreme Court reversed the decision. And one of the white girls brought more accusations, and they took them back into court, and this was drug out for 19 years. Now, here's the whole point, is that even Martin Luther King was accused of being friendly to the communists. And, of course, you know, for every red-blooded American, that was the worst thing that could have been said about Martin Luther King. I don't know what his contact was with the Communist Party. But my whole point is this, that don't you think that those 9 black boys that were sentenced to death were very grateful to the Communist Party that was willing to invest $1 million for the defense of these poor blacks in the time of oppression when blacks were being lynched throughout the South? Don't you think it would be reasonable that they would be very appreciative to the Communist Party? And so the whole point is that if you've been under oppression, you would thank God for anybody that would reach out a hand and that would offer you a reprieve. And then, of course, the truth is that the Communist Party was seeking to recruit poor blacks. They had already been appealing to the intellectual blacks and had made some inroads, but now they were wanting to reach out and to embrace the underdog. The Communist Party did not make any real significant inroads into the blacks. But the whole point is that we have criticized people for embracing certain people that were considered to be undesirables, but again, If you've been oppressed, you would thank God for anybody that would offer you any kind of hope.
Yeah.
One of the things that was very poignant to me was the fact that the statement was made in this Black History that blacks proved that they could live without proper housing accommodations and oftentimes could live without proper nutrition, but they couldn't live without hope. And none of us can live without hope. And there, anything that gave them hope, and then of course one of the things that gave the black people of this country hope through all these years was the black church, was the leadership of the black church. Well, we're going to have a time later on that we're going to be looking more specifically into the different minorities, and we'll probably be considering some issues that I think will be of interest to us. But we come to break time. Let's take about a 10-minute break, and when we come back, we're going to start on lesson 3. Okay, let's take a break.